Hey, so it's been 24 hours since I got access to the preview version of Devin, the AI software engineer that recently made the news. And I just thought I'd go ahead and put together an honest, unfiltered review of it after using it for the last 12 to 24 hours. So really quick, if you haven't heard of it, Devin is an AI agent that claims to be the world's first fully autonomous AI software engineer made by a company called Cognition Labs. And recently, there's been a lot of hype about Devin just because their demo, in my opinion, was one of the more impressive AI demos that came out this year, showing Devin easily being able to complete Upwork jobs, just do tasks that a software engineer would do end to end. And it was a really cool demo, really cool UX. But shortly after, we started to see a lot of YouTube videos, I think mainly starting with Internet Bugs, talking about how the demo was a scam and just a lot of the workflows were faked, or just like how Devin is just like a dumb AI and how it made a bunch of stupid mistakes, even though it looked like it completed jobs. So lots of talk around that. So with that all in mind, I just wanted to actually dive into Devin itself and go ahead and see if these claims are true. And so after 24 hours, I can I can for sure say that Devin is legit. To me, this is one of the most powerful tools I've used as a developer since Cursor. I think actually might be the most powerful AI tool I've used ever. And I can confirm that it's legit. You can see a lot of the critique being valid for sure. And I'm going to go into that in a second. But at a high level, just to cut to the chase, Devin is legit. There's still ways to go in some parts, but you feel like a different person before and after using this, especially if you're a developer. So in the past 12 hours, I've used Devin to first I tested on a really simple use case, which is adding a refund policy. I then had it prototype just one of my toy ideas I had, but in two different platforms, one in Next.js, one in Swift. It actually ended up deploying this Next.js one here, which is cool. And the third task was I had it build a desktop app that lets me control my code editor with my voice. So let me walk you through one of those projects so you can kind of see under the hood what Devin was doing. So the one I want to look at is that museum app. Basically, the idea was I wanted Devin to create a Next.js Tailwind TypeScript app that the high-level idea is that it turns the world around you into a museum by using your current location combined with the nearby geolocation feature on Wikipedia. And I wanted the main interface just to be a map. And based on the user's location, it'll do a lookup on what's nearby based on what Wikipedia deems as interesting features. And it'll display the relevant matches above the map. So very simple app. So we can see here, as Devin says, got it. I'll go ahead and set this up. And I'll get started on this now. So basically the first step that Devin does here is it creates a plan, right? So it's like, hey, Zach, here's the plan. And it basically breaks down the high level steps of how it would go about solving this task. And yeah, this is pretty much similar to how I guess I would think about it as a web developer. One other interesting thing about Devin is that it actually asks for input, right? One thing is that, like, you know, to build an app with just a text prompt, you're going from a very, very vague description to something that is very detailed, right? So one of the things I really like about Devin is that by kind of asking questions during our conversation, it allows Devin to get a better idea of exactly what I'm looking for, right? Because I didn't, you know, I did say I wanted a map as the main interface, but I didn't really specify the mapping service and what if I already had one in mind, right? So it's good for Devin to kind of chime in and ask these things. Yeah, so I respond, and it's interesting here too that I'm talking to it like I would another developer, right? I'm just like messaging someone on Slack who's going and doing this thing for me. And you can see here that sending messages don't interrupt Devin. So even while Devin is working, like sending you can just send messages and it'll update its thoughts and what it's doing based on your messages, which is really cool. Cool. So Devin's like, okay, great. Thanks for answering the question. Like, I'll go ahead and use OpenStreetMap because that's what I kind of specified these requirements and best matches them. And then it's like, okay, currently I'm setting up the Next.js project with Tailwind CS and TypeScript. Once that's done, I'll move on. So basically now it's starting to actually do the work. So it's finished the planning stage where it basically built this plan. And now it's like going through each step. You can even do things like you can see the what the code updates during this like notification message where like what was happening, which is super cool. But yeah, there's just like there's a crazy amount of technical features. I think is another thing I want to highlight about Devin. Like it's in the demo, they really didn't show the full breadth of what Devin could do. But yeah, it's quite powerful. And hopefully I can talk about that in a second. And yeah, so like Devin, you know, runs into things that a human developer would, right? It's like, hey, like, you know, to run this app, the app needs geolocation permissions. And it's, you know, like given Devin is a bot, maybe it can't like really click on them. So it asks me to do things for it. Right. So it's really interesting how it like kind of, you know, is aware of its limitations and asks me as a human to step in and unblock. Another thing is just like, I think in other apps, like where I'm asking to like integrate OpenAI and stuff, it asks for like my API keys, which, you know, it could be a little iffy, right? You're basically sending your API keys to another third party. But in this case, it understood how to like interpret the API keys, and then, you know, it went ahead and integrated it like a normal developer. So really cool. But anyways, yeah, so now the app continues working. Also, I want to call out, look at the timestamps here. So, you know, like, you know, I finished deploying the app at 1:34, at least this first deployment, and it started at like 10. So, you know, pretty slow, right? And I think it's because one of the things about Devin is that it's not just like, it's not just doing like one step at a time. I mean, it kind of is doing that, but another thing that it's doing is like it's self-checking, and if it runs into bugs, it'll modify its plan and then continue. So it's like not always like, you know, basically it's looping. Like some of these steps are loops that Devin is trying to go through to debug issues or other things. And so sometimes they take longer than others. Right, like yeah, you can see like the time difference between these steps is variable. Some of them, this one took like an hour. It's crazy. Anyways, so yeah, so basically I can now test it myself after I deployed it, and I noticed a bug. Devin was running into a loop. Like it wasn't succeeding getting past a step. It was stuck for a really long time. Even though like me being able to look at what Devin was doing gave me insight of like, hey, it's trying this thing and it's not working. So basically, I told it like the issue, which is just like, hey, after you set the location permissions, everything else works fine. So then it understood that and actually unblocked itself. So I thought that was really impressive, right? Like Devin, I think that's another flaw of Devin, which is that sometimes it'll get unblocked or sometimes it'll get blocked on really simple, dumb things. And one of the good things is that you can step in as a developer if you want to check in on it and unblock it yourself. So I thought it was a really interesting design pattern that they implemented, but it's quite useful. Okay, cool. So, yeah. So basically, Devin did more work and then finally succeeded in deploying the app. So it deployed it at 5:36. So it took almost the whole day, right? This is like a work day for Devin. That it took like 10 from 10 a.m. to 5:30 to deploy this like simple, kind of simple web app. But honestly, it's like about the speed is probably like a junior dev or, you know, mid-level dev, web dev would do as well. So it's like, it's pretty on par in that regard. They did have, like, Devin didn't need me to block, but still, I thought it was pretty impressive. And then, yeah, so, like, basically, it was handed off to me, right? And I went ahead and tested it. We can look at it now. At the time, there were, like, some bugs, so I went ahead and, like, reported them back to Devin. I was like, hey, like, can you, or not bugs, right? But I wanted to add features. So I was like, hey, can you do this? And then, yeah, I went ahead and did it. It took a really freaking long time and went from 7 to 9:42. So that's 2 hours to, like, make this simple CSS change that honestly could have taken most front-end devs, like, probably, like, 5 minutes. But it did it. And it did it on its own. So, yeah, I thought this... And, yeah, you can go ahead and see the app here. It's, like, around your location. You can go and click, and it'll show you kind of, like, what's around you. So, yeah, so that's basically an end-to-end walkthrough of one task that Devin did. And keep in mind, I wasn't just sitting over here monitoring this whole time, even though it was fascinating. In fact, I was running other commands at the same time. And this is the real power of Devin. I think this is where the real like aha moment hit my brain, which is just like, oh shit. Like I can run Devin on these pet projects that, you know, I honestly have always wanted to like prototype this app, but I just haven't really like had time to flesh it out. But having Devin being able to do it while it's doing other work tasks for me, like, you know, creating some like pages or like prototyping different apps is incredible. And so much so that I quickly hit the quota limit for the early preview, which it looks like is like 4 jobs a day, something like 5 jobs a day or something. Okay, so let's recap. So let's talk about the good and the bad of Devin. So the good, this thing really works. This thing is legit, and I understand a lot of where those videos calling Devin a scam are coming from. But come on, the only way to really know a product is by getting your hands on it and using it. And I'm curious to hear what they say after they get access to Devin. But I kind of went in with low expectations just because I tried other AI software engineering agents and they didn't quite work. But Devin, for so many reasons, in both the design, the development of their agent, and so many details that they've added that come together to create a much better experience. So I'll actually do a feature video on the UX because I think that's another big thing I want to call it. The UX for Devin is impeccable. And definitely want to dive more into that. But yeah, so Devin really excels at, in my opinion, first, it excels at building projects from scratch, right? We walked through that Next.js museum app, and it did a really good job all by itself. It took a long time. Yes, it took a really long time, but it succeeded in running a separate brain process of mine to go in end-to-end, like make something real without me having to spend a few minutes like kind of like helping it out. But overall, it was pretty hands-off. And I thought that was pretty powerful, especially since I was doing like three or four other projects of mine at the same time. I also find it pretty good for implementing changes of medium complexity to existing code bases. So medium being like, I don't know, something that would take a junior or mid-level dev like a couple hours to do, maybe like a senior, like an hour or two. So for non-developers, I feel like Devin is a tool that can increase productivity by a factor of 10. Or maybe more, right? Because now as a non-developer, if you have access to Devin and you have a basic idea of like what you want it to do, it can do it. It can freaking do it. Like you can tell it to build a portfolio site for you. You can tell it to build like a fully, probably a fully functioning e-commerce site, and it can do it. Like you can have it do a lot of things for you if you have no coding experience at all. But if you are a developer, especially a more senior developer that is very like well-versed on like software architecture and stuff like that, and system design, I think Devin's potential is far greater, because in my experience using Devin, when I gave it really simple prompts, you got what you expected, which is really simple, basic results. Exact same for ChatGPT, exact same for every LLM, just due to, you know, a lot of its parroting properties. But if you are a developer and you know what you want Devin to do, and you can give it the specific enough instructions that would save you tons of time to having to go back and forth with it and like figure out details. it's like a superpower, right? It's basically this. It claims to be a AI software engineer, but it feels more like you're hiring a team of software engineers that you can go and delegate tasks to. It's incredible. I am a big fan. But with that being said, let's go and talk about the bad. So as you guys already have heard me rant this whole video, it's slow. I would say it's not worth using for tasks that would take a dev like 5-10 minutes to do, right? Like one of the things I had to do was create a refund policy page. Oh yeah, this is the one. Create a refund policy page. But guys, the code is super simple, right? It's literally just content. And once again, it ended at like 11. Devin finished at 11 and I got it to start at like 10. So it took an hour for this really, really like literally like a 3-minute, maybe less, task. So just to give you an idea of how slow it is, yeah, that's like definitely a big thing to call out. And that's why I don't think of it as like, oh, what? I don't try to use it for the tasks that I need to get done necessarily today. I just use it to get tasks done that like are pretty high priority, but are like medium complexity. And yeah, it's something that like basically I can have Devin start in it now rather than me getting to it eventually, right? That's just kind of how I think about it. And so right now, the preview is free, but just given how many API requests Devin needs to call, it's like, right, it's looping, right? It's looping on itself and it's self-checking. I can't even count. I tried to estimate how many LLM calls I was thinking Devin was making during each of my runs, and I kind of gave up just because, yeah, I mean, one, you have no visibility over the checking part, like how many checking LLM calls is making. But my God, it takes a really long time. It takes a really long time, and I can't imagine that like they're making a ton of calls. So it'll probably be expensive, just depending on who their target audience is, right? I mean, they raise a bunch of money. If they go after an enterprise, they might just like not care about us, you know, like solo devs or like small startups. So yeah, we'll see how it goes. I mean, I really hope they like
introduce a price that is like friendly to all. But yeah, fingers crossed, because like I said, I feel like this Devin is the most powerful AI tool I've used ever. Much more than ChatGPT, more than Cursor, which is probably my second favorite AI product. So yeah, that's kind of it, guys. I encourage you guys to sign up for the Devin waitlist if you haven't already. Hopefully they can scale up access soon, because, you know, like I said, everyone's kind of on a usage limit right now, and I'm definitely eager to get that lifted. So yeah, hopefully they can come up with their general access soon, so everyone can play around with it. So peace.